My name is Billy FX, and I'm going to tell you how I self-taught my way to using 3D creation tools to making some of the most viral VFX videos on YouTube that got over 165 million views, how I grew to over 1 million followers on TikTok in less than 24 months, and how I became the lead PM for 3D mapping at a tech giant. And finally, I'll show you how you can use those same 3D creation tools to build for this thing called the Metaverse. The future is 3D, folks, so let's get right into it. I was 11 when I started my journey into computer graphics with Flash 5. This was back in the year 2000, where Flash was this amazing approachable tool to create animated visual content on the web, and it gave me amazing foundations for the basics of animation. For example, how to use a keyframe-based editor. I learned how to group graphics, create symbols that I could replicate and reuse across a bunch of different projects. But I'd watch TV shows like Mega Movie Magic and Splat on Discovery Kids, where I would see people using computers to create digital artwork that seamlessly blended computer graphics into live action footage. It was amazing. All the movies that I love, Terminator 2, Independence Day, Star Wars, did exactly that, blending the physical and the digital almost seamlessly. And I wanted to learn how to pull off this sorcery. And there started a foundational theme in my life, a quest to seamlessly blend the physical and the digital. So when I saw the software they were using in these TV shows, I wanted to adopt this new paradigm of 3D creation that was a step change beyond the 2D one that I was used to. Now, I was in India at the time, and I was lucky enough to find a local bookstore that had a copy of the 3D Studio Max Bible by Kelly Murdoch. Now, this book was as thick as can be. It is no surprise they call it the Bible. You look at this thing, and if it happened to fall on somebody's head, well, they would probably get really, really hurt. Now, included in this book was a CD-ROM. Remember those, kids? Which had a bunch of sample projects and renders. And this is really where the magic started. With this book and the CD, I got a glimpse into the structured creation process to make digital 3D assets and do all sorts of cool stuff. Today, this would be like buying a course on Shopify or watching something on YouTube, but I went through this massive book, page by page, not even having the actual software, and learning what it could be like to use 3D creation tools. Eventually, I was able to get the tool thanks to my dad's friend. So armed with 3ds Max 4, I had the keys to start opening up these sample projects. And it was amazing. I found this one Apollo command module project. I still remember looking at it vividly. It was so realistic. The reflections, the refractions, it just looked real. I couldn't believe that my computer was actually creating this unbelievably realistic imagery. It was amazing to see that the same PC I was using to make these cartoony animations was producing this level of realism that I didn't even think was possible with computers. This motivated me to create all sorts of sci-fi and action content. So literally armed with my cruddy Hi8 camera and a TV tuner card to capture that video, and of course, my trusty copy of 3ds Max, I went about recreating scenes from all my favorite movies, The Matrix, Terminator. I went deep into Autodesk forums online, learning from the amazing greats, including people like Master Zap, who actually ended up working at Autodesk eventually. Just look at the uncanny resemblance between our content here. At that point, I discovered this technique called image-based lighting, or IBL. This was like a whole nother world for me. It was essentially a way to capture a chrome ball, like a Christmas ornament, at a couple different exposures, or just the video clip itself, and then being able to use that information to light other digital objects that I wanted to insert into the scene. Now, the whole point was that that spherical capture could be unwrapped to essentially create an approximation of the lighting conditions in that scene. And so once you derive those lighting conditions, you can light new synthetic digital objects that you integrate seamlessly into that scene. And this was fantastic. And of course, like, this is how some of the most iconic scenes in Hollywood have been done. And using this technique, I made a bunch of fun videos. Now, when I think back on it, this is almost like offline augmented reality, because phones today can literally do exactly this image-based lighting estimation in real time on the phone in your pocket. Kids, you literally do not know how good you have it. So at this point I was rocking 3DS Max, and while it was a mean 3D software, I wanted to step things up even more. I wanted to make visual effects, create explosions, volumetric fluid effects, complex rigged characters, all this sort of stuff that was a little bit harder to do at the time in 3DS Max. And to do all of this, there was only one app in town called Maya. Being self-taught till this point, I wanted to learn from the experts, people who did this stuff for a living. Now, how would I have done that sitting in India? Well, luckily at this point in history, in the early 2000s, you had a surplus of young technical workforce that wasn't able to get engineering jobs. And within this void came visual effects and 3D animation. So highly technical tasks in movies like wire removal, 3D setup, character animation, set modeling, projection mapping, were outsourced to markets like India. Of course, with that came the need to train this technical workforce. And with a twist of fate, one of these schools opened up in my hometown called the Maya Academy of Advanced Cinematics, or MAC. So thanks to this academy in my little hometown in India, and of course a crappy internet connection, I was able to open up the world of Maya and digital creation. I was talking to the Corridor Digital folks on the FX Home forums. I was going to highend3d.com and downloading models and scripts, reverse engineering them, creating more complex rigs. You know, a pivotal moment for all of this was in ninth grade when I had the opportunity to go design space settlements for NASA as a part of the International Space Settlement Design Competition, or the ISSDC. As a part of this competition, you essentially become a part of a fictitious aerospace company and create proposals for space settlements in low Earth orbit, on the moon, and of course at Mars. As a part of this competition, I created this volumetric representation where the entire space settlement was essentially a virtual light probe that projected light to create an emulated sky and day and night cycle with the goal of improving human factors for the human beings living there. And that's basically what we do today with virtual production for things like The Mandalorian with these wraparound LED displays. So we won second place in this competition, and that gave me more excitement to pursue this 3D stuff in higher education. And having experienced a taste of the United States, I knew where I needed to be to do it, the US of A. After crushing it in my 10th grade board examinations in India, I got the opportunity to attend a college prep boarding school in Portland, Oregon, called the Oregon Episcopal School. And after that, I attended the University of Southern California, where I wanted to balance the technical and the business side of things. So I studied a dual degree in computer science and business, and I minored in 3D animation. The minor was awesome because it gave me opportunities to dig deeper into Maya and really up-level a bunch of my fundamentals. Techniques around character rigging, simulation, projection mapping, all the things that go into seamless visual effects. I also studied UI and UX design alongside it. User interface and user experience design, that is. And little did I know that the two would converge in the future. Fast forward a couple years after I graduated, and I'm working at one of the top consulting companies in the world, Deloitte Consulting, specifically in their Emerging Technologies and Digital Innovation Group. And over there, I had the opportunity to jump into AR and VR. Now, these type of projects were very atypical for analysts at that company, but the year was 2014, and of course, I was a Google Glass Explorer, obsessed with all things AR, so I had a pair of those dorky glasses. Combined with my background in 3D animation, computer science, and UI UX, it positioned me as a unicorn consultant whose skills were in demand. At that point in the early 2010s, the Internet of Things and virtual and augmented reality was just starting to gain steam again. I had the opportunity to work on Deloitte's wearable AR solutions and then their virtual reality solutions. Maya helped me tremendously because I was able to use it as my personal tool to simulate and prototype AR and VR in this high fidelity fashion, quickly defining product development and gaining stakeholder approvals. I was just able to innovate faster without being constrained by the tool because I was working in native 3D tools for native 3D mediums. The 3D understanding also put me in a very unique position to build real-time applications for virtual reality. Now, the Oculus DK2 had just come out at the time, and smart glasses were also a thing. So I had the opportunity to build productivity solutions for remote assistance and field service, creating augmented reality overlays for these awesome AR glasses. I also had the opportunity to work on all sorts of VR use cases, training simulations, architectural visualization, remote drone surveying, collaborative planning, interactive tours, the list goes on. It was a lot of fun. So what came next? I got promoted early, I felt like I was on a great path, but after 2 years of doing consulting, I was like, okay, I love enterprise, but I really want to do consumer. And this VR thing felt like it was about to blow up, so I made the decision to become a freelance creator. I jumped right into consumer VR creation, started my own YouTube channel, my Facebook channel, and created a runway for myself by moonlighting for VR startups in the Bay Area. I love 360 video, and when I looked at the content online, it was all travel content, barely any visual effects. So my goal was to create experiences that seamlessly blended the physical and digital, like simulating AR in VR, like the Snapchat filter that comes to life and wrecks San Francisco. At that point, there were a couple other streaming platforms that existed, like Vrdio, and my content quickly became viral on there, racking up millions and millions of views, first on Facebook, then on YouTube, with one of my top 360 videos getting over 50 million views on YouTube. All of these VR experiences were leveled up thanks to Autodesk tools like Maya. Since Maya was central to VFX and AR and VR, that allowed me to innovate quickly. I was able to create a unified set of 3D assets and creation workflows to really start developing rich three-dimensional content in this new immersive world. I made many experiences about AR and VR, even got featured by Autodesk to bring others along for the ride and help chart their entry into this new world. It was a humbling moment for me, a kid sitting in India, buying a used book to learn a software I didn't even own, to now actually evangelizing this software on that company's behalf. I won a couple of web VR hackathons, I made this awesome medical training experience for Stanford heart surgeons. And while this indie creator thing was a lot of fun, I was yearning to have a bigger impact in AR and VR and realized it was really only the biggest tech companies in the world that could make a dent in this nascent stage of this brand new immersive medium. So I joined big tech to make impact at scale. I joined the team at Google to create virtual and augmented reality content, from Coachella VR, to Elton John, to Teen Choice Awards, to collaborating with amazing YouTubers like So Crispy Media and Shutter Authority. I had the opportunity to shape billions of views on YouTube. And there was a theme I noticed. Again and again, production 3D artists were using 3ds Max and Maya. And as a deeply technical producer, that gave me the opportunity to speak their language and bridge that gap between vision and execution to really innovate in this field. Through my work as a technical producer, I got into product management and I got obsessed with software development. I kept the foundation of 3D, but just picked adjacent areas from AR platform, building APIs for mobile developers to create their own AR experiences, to 3D volumetric capture to scan athletes. Throughout, Maya was a staple in my repertoire. Now, as a tool for making so-called bad PM mocks to drive discussions with stakeholders and build cool stuff with engineering. And especially on technical teams where design resources were lacking, I got to flex the design skill set while weighing in on the business and technical needs as well. And that led me to what I'm doing today. And obviously I can't talk too much about that other than I'm mapping the world in 3D and creating some awe-inspiring experiences with it. But as a part of this transition for the past 3 years, I've had the opportunity to work with talented designers and technical artists that are far better than I will ever be. So there's no more a need for my bad PM mocks. So while my day job has been Google, I still yearn for this creative outlet to keep my 3D and VFX chops fresh. So my weekend hustle has become TikTok and YouTube creation. 24 months ago, I had a bunch of extra time, so I used that to get back into online creation. Now let's talk about how I got to 1 million subscribers on TikTok and almost 400K on YouTube. When I wanted to get back into creation, I revisited my core thesis for blending the physical and the digital. I was inspired by how creators like Mr. Beast were thinking about the algorithm on platforms like TikTok and YouTube. They were identifying this niche and this propensity that the algorithm had and really, really catered to it. My idea was that nobody was creating realistic 3D content on TikTok. It was a lot of talking heads and dance videos. So I'd make these shorts of alien and spaceship sightings, all done in VFX using Autodesk tools. It felt authentic, realistic, And luckily, since I had hopped onto the TikTok train in 2019 and already had a bit of a following, it really propelled me towards hitting a million very, very quickly. In many ways, it was like the perfect canvas of expression for me. Short form video that's like 15 seconds long, just long enough for me to hit a flow state in Maya and After Effects, and crank out a video on the weekend. And I do this to date, and gosh, I still love it. Clearly my audience does too. My top TikTok videos have gotten tens of millions of views. I've also been making AR filters for TikTok and other AR applications using these same 3D tools and even leveraging some of my existing assets. These filters are getting millions and millions of hits on TikTok. My favorite filter was one where I 3D scanned this statue in India and was able to create a face mask out of it. It was magical to be able to capture something from reality, like this 3D statue, edit it, and then see thousands of people making it their own. But let's look ahead to see where all of this is going. And here comes the big M word, the metaverse. The key point here is, with the metaverse, the tools of the trade remain the same. Let me unpack that. The metaverse is about convergence of all of these technologies. And while I won't get into a detailed definition of all of this, the key point I want to make in this video is, luckily, the same 3D tools we've been talking about are the very tools of the trade fundamental to creation in this final creative medium, this amalgamation of AR, VR, and the next iteration of the internet. Consider that all of the same skills apply. You model things, simulate things, rig things, paint vertex weights, create complex PBR shaders, create procedural effects, create complex animations, bake them down, decimate and optimize assets. All of these core skills that you learn with 3D tools are going to be fundamental to the metaverse. That you can be rest assured of. So regardless of where the metaverse goes, all of these core skills that you learn with 3D creation tools are going to be foundational to the metaverse. That you can be rest assured of. Want to feel even better about learning these tools? Well, there's an entire plethora of proprietary pipelines that exist in the industry, from media and entertainment and gaming to architecture, that have become reliant on Autodesk tools and build their workflows around 3D creation tools like Maya and 3ds Max. But these tools ain't going nowhere. There's just too much investment of proprietary tool chains and workflows around this Autodesk ecosystem. So just like people learn photo editing and video editing, 3D is that for the metaverse. So the currency, the tools of the trade, the raw materials are essentially going to be produced inside of 3D tools like Maya. What I encourage you to do is look into these 3D tools and figure out how they can empower you to turn your creative ideas into reality. Innovation is truly unhindered in this new medium. And unlike when I was a kid, you've got a phone in your pocket that can do more than you can imagine. You've got a plethora of online resources to download 3D models, consume free courses, connect with communities, and ask detailed questions. You can pretty much create whatever you set your mind to. So I hope my journey was helpful. If you click the link in the description, you can check out a bunch of awesome tools Autodesk offers for 3D creation. I'm super excited for you to check this stuff out and empower yourself to create for this next creative medium. And that's all for today. Talk to you again later. Bye.